All right, welcome back on AdobeLife.com. I'm joined here with Martina Flohr, who's going to be continuing to amaze us with some lettering skills. And today, well, actually, let's start talking about you first and introduce you. Who are you, Martina?
Well, I'm a lettering artist. Uh-huh. I'm based in Berlin. I run my studio, like mm-hmm. my tiny studio in lettering and custom typography there. And I work for clients all over the world.
How long have you been living in Berlin?
Well, now I think around 7 years. Okay. I don't know exactly the date. Okay. Everyone asked me, but I don't know exactly the date where I...
So do you speak German yet?
Yeah. Yes? Actually, oh, okay. Yeah. Well, I mean, not as a native, but okay. Yeah, I can deal with that. And, you know, with the time I started to have some German clients, mm-hmm. so I have to, you know, that pushed me a little bit forward into learning the language.
Okay.
But yeah, I also work in English mostly and in Spanish sometimes, mm-hmm. Which is my mother mm-hmm. language. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Awesome. I just wanted to start a little bit with your website here.
Sure.
And let me just send the big one. Okay. Boom. Okay. So this is martinaflohr.com. And basically, this is where you keep your portfolio.
Yeah, sure.
Right?
Yeah.
Do you maybe want to talk a little bit about the things that we're seeing here, or maybe is there something that you want to point out that is really representative of you?
Or... Well, I guess I try to keep my portfolio updated because I think that kind of brings my work forward mm-hmm. in terms of, you know, as I show new work. Clients might come after that new work, and that's I think it's good. And I work in very different in projects of very different profiles. I work for identities, so I do logotype, mm-hmm. like wheel, logotype design. I also do. I work a lot for publishing houses and magazines. Mm-hmm. This is kind of my favorite sort of job. So I do magazine covers and book covers, and I do work for with agencies, and I do advertising campaigns mm-hmm. and stuff. So my work is pretty varied in this sense.
So this is martinaflohr.com, and right there at the bottom there is links to your Facebook, your Twitter, your Instagram, your Pinterest, and your Behance.
Yeah, I'm everywhere.
You're everywhere.
Well, not really. Actually, I feel that now I'm missing a couple of networks, but okay. These are the ones that I really like to be in. Mm-hmm, yeah, mm-hmm. And I enjoy like interacting with people and stuff. Yeah.
All right. So I think now we're going to be seeing a completely different way of approaching lettering. Mm-hmm. We saw Will for the first 2 hours of the show today using an iPad to sketch in Adobe Photoshop Sketch and then yeah. move that over to Illustrator. You, on the other hand, you always start like with sketches and on paper, right?
Yeah.
Paper and pencil.
Yeah, that's true. I'm open to try new techniques. When I was watching Will's live stream and I was thinking like, oh wow, he can move things around, you know. I have to actually cut paper and then you know, shift the paper. Maybe I have to do that shift. But yeah, so far I've been always working with paper, and it's being a time-saving mm-hmm. technique, you know, as I'm the only one doing the actual work in the studio, mm-hmm. then I had to come up with, you know, techniques to be able to work fast.
To speed it up, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. And, you know, also, you know, sketches are a good way of sort of sharing your ideas with the client. So, mm-hmm. You know, being able to say to the client, hey, I like this idea or mm-hmm. I like this direction. What do you think? Do you like the lettering style? Mm-hmm. Do you like the composition? You know, it's a very good stage to discuss things. Mm-hmm. And as you know, as the digital work, as you will see maybe in the next days, you know, digital drawing takes a lot of time.
Yes.
You know, drawing with mm-hmm. vectors takes a lot of time. So it's a good way of saving time. If you have this through the sketching process, you have a lot of time saved mm-hmm. for the digital drawing. That's It's always a bliss. Yeah.
Great. So those of you who are watching us on YouTube, come on over here to adobelive.com because the experience is really fuller and richer there, because we also have the chat there. We have special tabs with the schedule for all of the upcoming streams for the 3 days, because this is day one of three. You will be with us 3 days.
Sure.
So adobelive.com is where the action actually happens. So come on over to adobelive.com. There's also a tab for a contest, which I'm going to be talking about in a second. And during your session, we will also be giving away prints of whatever you're working on, the final result that will be produced for Thursday.
That's great. So it's actually a challenge to get an artwork done in 3 days. So.
Everything done in 3 days.
Yeah,
wow. Actually 6 hours. Are you stressed?
A little bit.
We will also be giving away Creative Cloud subscription second hour of the stream. And so why don't we get started, and let me just move over to your screen here.
Sure. Yeah.
And actually to your screen to your screen. Yes.
So because... yeah, actually my workspace. So uh-huh. This will be my workspace for the next mm-hmm. 3 days. So Will was live streaming before me, mm-hmm. and he was sketching live on the iPad. So I a couple of days ago I was thinking what will make sense to do during this live stream, or to draw actually, and I was thinking, well, Valentine's is coming, so let's draw something related to Valentine's. I came up with love. It's not like out of the world. Yeah. But I have to say that whenever I want to try a new style, or even in my workshops, mm-hmm. when I have people coming over, I always say that the best thing is to just concentrate on one word or mm-hmm. a couple of words, and it's much easier to, you know, you don't have so many letters to draw, mm-hmm. so it's much easier to get something done that is consistent and looks good. So I thought, let's do the word love. So normally, you know, in a commission process, I would start by doing thumbnail sketching. Mm-hmm. So these are very small, 5x5, even smaller, I think it's 3 centimeters by 3 centimeters sketches. So I start by, you know, thinking how that will look in the page, which kind of composition I'm gonna use, whether I'm gonna use script lettering. I don't know if you can actually see. Wait, let me
you
do
can
this.
Move the camera.
Yeah, that's great. Mm-hmm. So here it was, thinking of which kind of lettering style I want to use, if I want to use something a little bit more, with line work, or this script lettering sort of style, or if I want to do something a bit more chubby and more, with some sort of brush lettering style. So in this thumbnail sketching, I actually decide which kind of direction I'm gonna follow. And this is only for me, it's something I don't show to clients mm-hmm. or to anyone else. It's just for me to decide how do I want mm-hmm. this piece to look. No? And after I find something that I like, for instance, this one here, then I move into something bigger. So I will just take this and make a copy and, you know, scale it a little bit bigger so I can work on the details and continue working on that.
I noticed that you have the Creative Cloud Mola skin.
That's true.
Did you ever use it the way that it was meant to be used?
Yeah, actually, I just started using this. I have to say that, you know, here in the other page, I have my 2017 goals.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
So I actually try to, I have the app.
Yes, the app. Yep.
So you have this a notebook, and then you have an app, and when you take a picture, you can directly digitize whatever you draw mm-hmm. on this into a digital file. So I didn't try it with that, but I tried it with my handwriting mm-hmm. and it actually works pretty good.
Yeah. So basically that's a special Moleskine sketchbook that you know that you can get directly from Moleskine online, or if you go to a Moleskine store, they have them as well, and you can recognize them from the Creative Cloud logo. So
So
I just wanted to point that out because I noticed the little dots on the page, and basically these little dots here.
They
serve to actually straighten everything up. So even if you take a picture that's not straight, you know, it just straightens up everything.
Okay, that's great. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think I'm just going to use it. Like I have, this is something extra. I always use Moleskine too, you know, for my as a sketchbook. So I think it's it's an extra tool.
Maybe we can try it at a later time during
these
2 days
that
we have together.
So, so I have my thumbnail drawing over there, right? So what I did is just to make a copy of it, or a photocopy.
Well, people are asking what the app is that we're talking about. Basically, it's the Adobe Creative Cloud Moleskine app. And basically, it's an app that lets you take a picture of your Moleskine page, the one that you want to digitize, and it puts it into the Creative Cloud so that you can continue working on it in other applications.
Yeah, I think it's pretty useful when you're, when you're working with as an illustrator, or when you're doing dribbles and stuff. Mm-hmm. I think it's a pretty easy way to, you know, transfer your drawing into a detailed file.
Or even to digitize notes.
Yeah, that's true. Totally. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All right. So let's talk about the project.
I have my thumbnail drawing, and then I
maybe
do
we
this.
Can put the camera a little bit closer.
Yeah. Or should I just grab it?
Yeah, just grab it.
Yeah, I just lift it like this.
Okay.
Here we are.
All
right.
All right.
Wow.
But I don't want you to hold that camera all the time, so.
All right.
So maybe just for a little.
Okay. So just for a while. Then so here I have my thumbnail drawing, sort of scaled. You know, it's pretty rough, but this would be like the basis for the rest of my sketches. So on top of this drawing or this photocopy, I will start working with tracing paper, which are these, you know, layers that I have over here. So I would just try, pick up whatever I like from this drawing into this new layer and, you know, change the things that I don't like. Is that clear?
Yes.
Sort of,
like,
you know.
Like always perfecting.
Exactly.
Each new layer lets you perfect the preceding one.
Totally. And the good thing about this.
Almost sounds like poetry.
Yeah, yes. Totally. You explained that much better than me. This technique is something that I think many letter designers use because it has proven to be really useful. And, I can tell by myself that what is great about this technique is that it lets you explore a lot more because you are not like starting over every time. And, you know, you don't have this fear of, oh my God, I'm gonna destroy the drawing. Or if I erase this part, then I don't have it there anymore, you know? So this is the problem with hand sketching, that you're always, you know, even starting over or even like erasing parts, then you think like, okay, I cannot undo this, you know?
Yeah,
like,
no, there's no undo on
there's
paper.
There's no undo. So I think what's great about this is that you can always go back to your previous layer. Hmm. That's basically what I would do usually. And
just a second, because Zoheb is asking, you know, if you can talk a little bit about the inspiration that was behind, you know, like doing this.
Yeah.
How would you say, like, is it splash or is it floral?
I have to say that, you know, there's, I have to say that my work is the things I use as inspiration or as keywords when I start a lettering piece are really straightforward, really easy. And there's, of course, in all the pieces I do, there's certain storytelling. There's something I want to communicate, right? So if I'm talking about love, then what is it that I want to say? Love is sweet, love is sometimes rough. So how can I, how can I express that into my drawing? So in this case, it was like, okay, let's use like soft shapes. I might think later into incorporating, you know, on a new layer, I can try out other solutions. Like, what if I, you know, I come up with some spikes into this to bring this roughness of, you know, love might be rough sometimes. So how can I incorporate this in my drawing? And, you know, it sounds like really obvious, but I think whenever you're working with typography, if you're trying to tell too many stories, then your letters will try to adapt to those many stories. So, and you will lose your focus, which is actually doing something that people can read and that communicates the idea. So keeping it simple and sometimes really obvious can help you do a nice, well-crafted piece of lettering or of typography. So in this case, yeah, I thought I would work with organic shapes and something that feels lively and soft. Yeah.
Cool. Awesome. Michael, maybe if you can put in a link to the app that we were talking about, the Moleskine app. And maybe let me see if we can move the camera just a little bit closer, maybe.
Yeah, sure.
Just with the, something like that, maybe. Yeah, perfect. That looks very good.
That's great. I was thinking maybe maybe we can work. I have here a couple of layers, which normally appear in my process. I have processes that take more or less layers. So normally I would continue, like I have here layer number 2, I have a layer number 3, so I can...
So you name your paper layers.
Yeah, yes. Well, I mean, ideally, yeah. You know, there's times in the year where everything is kind of busy and chaotic, and I have to reorganize my drawings by the end of the year. But yeah, ideally it's cool to, you know, keep track of your of your own process.
The same you would do in Photoshop or Illustrator, right?
Exactly. Yeah. I think what is great from this technique is that it's actually it's the same than working digitally in Illustrator, for instance. So whenever you work in Illustrator, when you want to try something new, then you would probably duplicate the layer and work on that layer so you don't miss whatever you did before. So in this case, it's the same. So you're doing the same process, but analog, right?
Okay.
So, I mean, I can try things up on top of this. So
I already noticed that maybe people will notice as well. Like, for example, these three dots here. These three dots.
Yeah.
Were like this before, so you took a different decision on the three dots.
Yeah, that's true. I'm also working here on how do I want to. You know, if you look at this area of the drawing, I don't know if I can show it there. If you look at this area of the drawing, this is much more complex than this here. I simplify the shapes and the number of bubbles, let's say. So that's the idea with every layer, you know, to try to improve the composition, to see what's the best way, you know, this E will become more or less readable.
And Junior is saying he's taking your course in Domestika.
Oh, really? Yeah. That's
greetings from Peru.
Nice. Okay. I will continue drawing on top of this.
All right.
Let
let's
me
get going.
Put the camera here. So I spoke about incorporating, you know, on every layer, I just look at the layer and I think like the things I would like to change. I have the feeling here, for instance, that, you know, this bubbles or this drops here have a certain contrast which means like the difference between the thick part and the thin part. I feel that here they have a certain contrast that is not reflected on the shape. So I was thinking if I could bring some more contrast into the letter shape. So, you know, decorative elements and shapes sort of share certain features. So if you look at the L, for instance, the contrast, the difference between the thick parts and the thin parts and the thick parts are not as extreme as here, right? So yeah, in this layer, I would just try to work towards that direction and towards bringing a little bit more of contrast into the letter shapes.
Basically, the thick and thin concept comes from using a pen. Tool. And basically when you move the pen over the paper, that's where the thickness and the thinniness. No, that's not a word. I just made that up.
Yeah, but what would be the word? I'm not sure, really.
Yeah, basically it comes from, yeah, from other materials, from other tools that were used when hand drawing. Oh, thank you for the link to the Moleskine app. Computer Completions is asking if while you're doing that, maybe you can provide some tips on pencils you're using, you know, the hardness, maybe the types, maybe the paper you're using.
So sure, I use really like normal copy paper to draw. And then this is, I buy this tracing paper in rolls and it's 40 grams tracing paper. I think it's, you know, it's a the perfect weight because it's not too thick, it's transparent enough. These are the basic tools I use. I use an automatic pencil because you don't have to sharpen it basically, but you can use any paper. There's not more, you know, a fanciness to it, really. So what I basically do here is to, I'm just drawing. If I don't know if you can see the difference, but I just, you know, I draw the L and I added some more contrast to it. Mm-hmm. If you see the, you know, the thin part is now a little bit thinner. So I just have the outline, and what I always do when I'm drawing is to feel the shape right away. I think that's pretty important. Sometimes, you know, it's very common to concentrate only on the outline, and I think it's really important when you're drawing that that you feel the shape, because you can get an idea of how thick your shape is. If you're only working with an outline, it's really hard to see whether that L is too heavy or whether that thin part is too thin. Or
one thing I do as a designer is to squint when I look at things. Do you do that too?
I don't know what
like squint
is.
Like this?
Oh yeah, totally. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yeah, that totally helps. And I have to say that I work pretty fast. I have to say that my first drawings are pretty rough. If you look at this, it's fairly rough. Mm-hmm. So first you want to try to find, you know, the overall shapes, and then later on you can focus into, you know, perfecting those curves and improving little details and stuff. I just work very fast.
So White Rose, yes, Martinez is refining her sketches before bringing it into Illustrator. Actually, we will not be using Illustrator at all today. We will continue to sketch, to refine the sketch, and then we will move it over to Illustrator and make the final piece.
Yeah, I think so. I think you know, having once, I know that, you know, nowadays we don't work by hand so much. So sometimes when you speak about working or sketching by hand, it's like, oh no, I lost all my sketching skills and stuff. Like I suck at sketching and stuff. But I think, you know, once you practice a little bit, like sketching can get really fast much better. And
I'm actually seeing it, and I was like thinking in my head, sketching what you're sketching right now would have probably taken much longer to ideate.
Totally.
And, you know, and like trying to make Bezier curves and things like that.
And,
way you're doing it, but I guess that's also years of practice, of also filling in and things like that.
But I have to say that, I mean, if you go on the internet and you Google, you know, sketchers or draw or people who's drawing and stuff, they do much better drawing than I'm doing right now. But I think it's, you know, it just has to work for yourself, for you to be able to get the shapes as fast as you can. It doesn't matter really if you have a perfect line, and, you know, it's not about doing this perfect sketch, but it's about having, you know, a workflow that works for the kind of job you're doing. If you work directly, like if you're trying to do a sketch in digital curves, I think first it would take a lot more time, and also if you need to show that digital sketch to a client, since the curves and the, you know, the Bezier curves and the vector curves in Illustrator are, you know, are much more neat, then you get to see all the mistakes, all the bumps and stuff, and showing a sketch sort of disguises all these problems.
It leaves it open to interpretation as
well.
Totally. Yeah.
So whenever the client approves whatever you're doing, if you're showing a sketch and you say like, hey, I would like to go on these directions, there are a lot of things that are open to interpretation, which you would like to, you as a designer, you would like to keep for yourself to decide later. Otherwise, the work becomes really boring when you get into the digital drawing. So it's cool to have some things to decide upon when you move.
There's people here that are asking, do you recycle your paper or do you store them? You're using a lot of paper.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's true. I do keep like a folder. I have like a big folder where I keep, you know, with paper, and then I put my sketches in between these papers. I also like to keep like a digital documentation of my sketches. So whenever I get to a final sketch, which I'm gonna digitize, I scan it in a fairly high resolution. So I will normally scan a sketch in 600 dpi or something. So it's cool to have, you know, the sketch saved somewhere, but it's also cool to have the digital file for yourself. I don't know, that's that's what I do. So I'm changing here, like, for instance, the features of the E. I feel that the other E on the other drawing and the previous layer has a lot of space. You know, if you compare the E with the O, has a lot of, you know, inner space. So I'm trying to find ways to close that up. So I'm gonna do this loop of the E a little bit bigger, so it will take up some of that white space. So these are just, you know, trials. Maybe it doesn't look good, but it's an idea I came up with. So I'm filling in the shape again.
Yeah, I find it fascinating that you know, that there's so many different ways of creating. I love that Martina is using you know, a pencil and tracing paper. I love the fact that Will Patterson, for example, is using his iPad and an Apple Pencil to draw in Adobe Photoshop Sketch. There's so many different ways, and I think the rule of thumb here is that there is no right or wrong way. There's just the way that works best for you, and I think that's the key thing here.
Yeah, totally. I think the workflow needs to work for yourself. I think in terms of process, you don't really need to perfect any of those tools, you know? You don't need to be perfect at iPad sketching or at hand sketching. You just need to be as good as to be able to communicate something with that sketch or to define some stuff on that sketch.
So that's a question that comes up very frequently. Like, typically, how long would it take you to, you know, to deliver a final piece to a client?
That's a common question, and that's a hard one too.
Yes.
Like,
because it can take very little time or very long time, depending on the client, on the project, on the deadline.
That is true. I think I would say that, you know, the thing that defines this mostly is the deadline. Mm-hmm. Like, the closest deadline is the faster, or at least in my case, the faster I can work. I have to say that I work pretty good, or I can deliver pretty good under pressure. Mm-hmm. And when the client says, like, okay, you have a month to finish this piece, well, then it's like, I would maybe take a month to...
Do you procrastinate? Do you wait until 2 days before the
deadline
and then start?
And but also, you know, maybe I will be investing into that project a lot more time back and forth and back and forth. Whereas in a project that has to be delivered in 3 days, I would just work straightforward, you know? Like, I think it works a little bit like, you know, when, for instance, you go to a workshop that lasts 3 hours and you have to do, I don't know, draw a capital D. Mm. So you have 3 hours to draw this capital D. And you have it done in 3 hours. Otherwise, you go home with nothing. So I think a little bit works that way. So to answer to that question, I think it depends a lot on the project. It depends a lot on the deadline. But you know, what I can say is that the sketch might take up to 3 hours normally. Like, there are sketches where, you know, this sort of process by hand and stuff might take up to 3 hours. Mm-hmm. And that's really great because you can send the client a sketch right away and then have a lot of time or all the time you need to do the digital drawing. So I'm working on, you know, these decorative elements there. Maybe I should tell a little bit what I did over here. So I don't know if you can see this. Let me shift a little bit the paper. Can you see that there? I was just shifting the camera.
Yeah, just... The audience loves when you do that.
Oh yeah, okay.
Yeah. They're saying, oh, it would be great to have it over the top camera, like somewhere here, you know, like that.
Yeah,
looks down,
that's true, that's true. Yeah, that's true. So I did something pretty rough, but you can get an idea of the things I changed. So the E has become a little bit more compact. Quite heavy, actually. I think I would like to change that in the next layer, that the E is rather heavy. But I have solved this issue of the, you know, that the counter had a lot of air over here, or like a lot of white space, and that's something I wanted to solve. So now it's a little bit more enclosed. You know, the L, now this loop over there, or this swoosh over there, is a little bit more compact as well. Over here, and I think it sort of helps to reconstruct that L. What else did I change? I changed the contrast of the letters. So this L had very few contrasts, so now it has a fairly thinner, thin part, let's say. And that applies to the other letters as well. So I will move forward just to give you an idea of what changed so far.
Perfect.
Yeah. So
you are at Adobe Max, our annual Creativity Conference in San Diego.
Yeah.
Yes. What did you do there?
I gave a talk. So I gave a talk about, of course, yeah, I spoke a little bit about my work, but also from a very personal take, how did I get into lettering and how, you know, the environment in which I was, which was Germany. I just moved to Germany and, that was the moment where I actually decided to become a letterer or, you know, just do lettering,
to focus on
lettering. And yeah, how that happened. But also I spoke, you know, lately when I have the chance to speak at big conferences and, to speak to art directors or designers, I speak a lot about standards, you know, like what makes, a good lettering piece and what can you look at to actually recognize, hey, that's a well-crafted lettering piece and that perhaps needs a bit more work and stuff. You know, that there's so much out there right now in terms of lettering that I think, and it's a rather, there has been a sort of lettering boom, and I feel that, you know, we need to create some standards so this sort of a scene or this industry steps on solid basis, sort of. I try to convey some standards or some criteria so you can recognize, or you can. So you're also, if you're a creative director, you have more tools to actually commission lettering.
That's actually an interesting point, because this type of lettering is actually pretty new in design history, right? If there is nothing in the 1900s that, you know, maybe yes, like there was like some very heavy lettering in the 60s and 70s maybe. I think before that and after that, everything was more precise, and there was, you know, more openness, more freedom in letters, in letter shapes at that point. Yeah, in the 60s and 70s maybe. And now it's like becoming really back as a trend. And
that's true. And there's also like what you could call like illustrative lettering. So there's this sort of lettering acting as an image, for instance, a book cover, or, you know, illustrating some story over there. But I mean, if you go, for instance, here in Paris where we are, if you go outside on the streets and you look up, you will see a lot of, lettering on facades of stores and stuff. And, you know, it's true that they are much more controlled in terms of perhaps shapes and effects, if you want to call it, but they're also telling a story about that store, you know, like it's not the same a boulangerie or a bakery that it's bakery, right? A bakery that has like a well-crafted sign than a bakery that has like just a type uploaded
Helvetica.
On. Exactly. Yeah. So then it tells you a lot about how that bakery works, and perhaps you tend to think that, you know, on one bakery the bread will taste better than another bakery just because of how the sign looks. Yeah, I mean, it also works for me. So I think it's been out there for a long time, but now, it's it has it has gone to another level or incorporated other. Tools and the digital tools, computer graphics and stuff. So, you know, sketching is pretty dirty.
Yes.
Can be pretty dirty. You don't get this with the iPad.
Do you ever get, like, this was a question that I had in the chat, do you ever get cramps or do your hands get tired?
That's a very important question. I think with the time you have to try to consciously relax your hand and try not to apply so much pressure on the pencil. I think that's the best way to also lose your hand and draw better shapes. But yeah, in the beginning I did, but now I kind of learned to lose my hand a little bit more, to relax the hand.
I'm looking at Twitter a second to see if there's any submissions with the Adobe Live hashtag for you to look at.
So how does that work? How this Adobe hashtag? Adobe
yes, Live people are submitting lettering that they did, and we're going to be looking at them in a second.
All right.
To get your input on this.
Oh, that's great. I love to criticize.
Yes, so please do share on Twitter with the Adobe Live hashtag, like Michael just wrote in the chat. And we will review those in a few minutes. I'm just human. I'm glad you like watching live video on YouTube. But if you're watching this on YouTube, please come over to adobelive.com because the full experience is right there. Because we have a little tab that says, that gives you the whole schedule. We will be streaming for 3 days here on adobelive.com. This is the second part of day one. And we will be joined by Peter Sizer and also Charlotte Smith later today. We're actually streaming live from Paris. And yeah, it's a late afternoon here, and we're going to be going on until midnight Central European time, which would be 3 p.m. Pacific time for those of you in the U.S. By the way, why don't you guys let us know where we're all from in the chat? All right, New York, Charleston, Warsaw, Russia, Denver, I guess that's Denver, Toronto, Texas, Netherlands, Peru, Chicago, San Francisco, Armenia, Austria, Colombia, Brazil, anybody from Australia? Still, oh, New Zealand, there we go. Near, very close. Canada, I think we have almost all continents represented here today. Wow. Africa, anyone? That's awesome. Thank you, guys.
Wow, amazing.
Yeah.
So, I had a couple of things to say already from here. Do we have a white piece of paper somewhere?
Yes.
To have a background.
Mm-hmm. There you go.
Ah, that's great, thank you. So.
No Antarctica. No, not today.
No.
All right. So this is sketch 3 and this is sketch 4.
Exactly, this is sketch 4. So what I basically can tell you about this is some decision making that I did, you know, between one and the other sketch. Like, the dots are missing. See, I have to incorporate those, but there's some connections missing. For instance, the V has no connection now, which I think works much better with this kind of E, because it's not really connecting with that E. So this connection here is missing here, which I think works better and makes the whole shape a lot simpler. The L is simpler now. I sort of, you know, try to simplify all these drops over here, a little bit here. I think I'm missing sort of the heart shape now. I have to improve that. You know, this looks a little bit flat. Before it was a slightly more fluffy. It moves slow, but it moves forward, right? And if you think about it, it didn't take it. I mean, now because I'm speaking and you know, we are chatting while I'm doing this, but actually, if you're focused on doing the thing,
you then, do many more sketches.
Yeah, and, yeah, totally. And this goes really fast. You know, this sketching is so rough that it goes really fast. So yeah.
All right, I'm uploading, reloading the Twitter feed with the hashtag Adobe Live, and I'm going to move back in time a little bit, and we're going to be looking at some of these things. I will only show things that have been submitted in the last maybe 40 minutes.
Okay, great.
And whenever you're ready, we can have a quick look at them.
Sure.
And get your constructive feedback. Are you ready?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. All right. So now we're looking at your submissions on the on Twitter with the Adobe Live hashtag. And there's quite a few submissions here. And thanks for being awesome, Adobe Live.
That's great. That seems to be made with some sort of brush, right? Mm-hmm. Like, thanks. And I bet being is vector drawing, or it looks like. Nice. It's looks like a nice composition.
Yeah. Maybe it's based on what Will Patterson was doing, like more like with using Illustrator to create these lines.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you, Val.
So that's sort of like a logo, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You're looking at left pink. Okay, we can see that on the. That seems like a trace logo from a hand drawing.
Yes.
Right. So tomorrow we will be looking at some techniques to actually digitize hand sketching or hand sketches. That is, you know, it's pretty useful when you draw letters, and also gives you a lot of control on the shapes.
And I think one very essential part is, like, both in typography and hand lettering is kerning.
Yeah,
like
totally.
This, you know, it's basically the space between letters, and basically the white and dark areas that have to sort of work in proportion. Let's see, like that. And maybe in this case, maybe I see a little problem here with the kerning, you know, with the F. Maybe a bit too far away. Maybe I would have put it a little bit closer.
Yeah, that's true. I think also that, you know, since it seems a drawing that was auto-trace mm-hmm. in Illustrator. You know, it doesn't allow you to control that shapes, whereas if you draw it from zero or from scratch, then it's you deciding the shape of that letter.
Let's watch this video. I haven't looked at it before. Well, this has very little to do with lettering, though.
Okay, yeah.
It's an animated GIF. Okay. All right. Monoline lettering.
All right, yeah.
From Alessandra.
That's interesting. Mm. I think that looks pretty much based on handwriting. And I think that's, you know, handwriting, if you have a good handwriting, it's definitely a tool you can use for your lettering. I think it's always a plus when letters have good handwriting because they can use it for, you know, as even like this, like a monoline lettering, or they can even use it as a basis for developing further, no?
We have some hand lettering with a cupcake.
Okay.
I like that. I think that works quite well.
Yeah, actually it's pretty, because you can still read the, you know, you can read cake and still reconstructs the cupcake, so.
There's a, let me see, let's open that in a new window. Oops, not available. Okay, sorry about that, Dot Louis.
Nice, okay, that's I would call that more calligraphy.
Yeah.
Right? So just to make it clear, like, the, you know, we say that calligraphy is writing with a tool and lettering is drawing letters. So,
and I think one very important thing also in both in hand lettering and typography, of course, is when drawing letters, the letters should be drawn the way they are written. Like, for example, I have a big problem with the X here because it's not really an X. It's like two shapes like this, and basically the X is really
like
two lines
intersecting.
That's
true. Yeah,
and but very nice calligraphy.
Yeah,
and it looks like it's been done with this pen.
Yeah, I think so.
All right, this also looks like it's maybe traced, auto traced.
Yeah. Wow, we have a pro here.
Yeah, this is this from Judith. That's very heavy. Yeah, that's very nice.
That's very nice. I like how consistent. You know, you can clearly see what we were speaking about before, this this concept of contrast. You can clearly see that you know, there's a very extreme contrast. Like the thin parts are rather thin and the thick parts are very thick, and it's very consistent in terms of, you know, the weight is always in the bottom of the letters, so you can see that throughout all the lettering, and I think that's really well done.
Okay, so Sumon, I think this is something that you were talking about before, like maybe, like, I think your process of like maybe starting a little bit complicated and then like simplifying things, I think that's one example of where maybe we need a little bit of simplification.
Yeah, that's true. I think you know, it's really common in you know, in my experience at teaching, like it's very common that someone that is you know, starting with lettering feels really attracted by, you know, doing a lot of flourishing and a lot of swirls, and I think that, you know, it looks really easy, but it's actually not. Like after a while, you start, you know, with doing so much flourishing and swirls and curls, you sort of, you know, they start looking as letters. So they start competing with your letters themselves.
Yeah, because in this case, the thick and thin is only at the ends.
Yeah.
And basically the thick and thin is really, imagine you have an ink pen and basically it would go thick, thin, thick, thin, thick, oops, whoa, okay, thin up here again, and then thick on here, thin, and it's really that's how the shape is made. And the reason why we do the thick and thin doesn't come just because it's nice. It's because we're used to it. That's how letters work. Using these tools. So great, Suman. Okay, this
so
is.
So I would say, Suman, try to keep it simple in the beginning, and then you can add upon, you know, some flourishing later.
Here's from Beth, Adobe Live with Martina Flor. Mercy, kids.
Sorry, I will ask for more water.
Okay, sure. You want
water is good. Thank you.
I bring you both.
Okay. Okay, so we have also nice. Okay. There might be a lot to say also because, so I'm talking about Beth, there might be a lot to say because also you're dealing with a lot of text, right? So what I was saying in the beginning, just try to focus like I'm doing now, try to focus on one word will help you, you know, to get that word right and to learn a lot of things from that word. And then you can letter all this
Because I see nice things happening with the word joy here.
Exactly.
I see mercy.
And I think, you know, focusing on joy or mercy or whatever,
or hope,
like,
or whatever. Yeah.
Exactly. Then you get that letter shapes right, and you know how to continue with other words. But now it's just too much to deal with, right? For anime fans, okay. Okay, looks anime.
Like the first part, yes.
Yeah, there's, I would just, you know, try to keep in mind the spacing of the letters. If you look at, you know, O-T, they look, you know, rather, like the space between the T and the A is sort of big and makes that word look as two different words. So I can tell you a tip. There's you know, a principle that says that the letter, the space within the letter, so the space that you see, the white space that you see within the A, for instance, you know, should be the same as the space between the letters. So if that, you know, if that space is would be water, you should be able to feel.
Now squinting, all it needs is squinting, and it's like when you squint.
Yeah, that's true.
The T and the O already like are
they look
coming
pretty,
together.
Yeah.
There is too little space here compared as to the space here, and basically it's all a matter of composition at
totally.
That point. And also here, maybe again here, like thick and thin,
yeah.
very important because now it's like a pretzel. Right. Like,
yeah, that's true.
And if it all it takes is a little bit of, you know, thin, thick, thin, thick here, thin again, and then thick, you know, to make the Y.
I think continuing with this idea of what you say, I think that this is something that is not so easy for when you're starting with lettering. I mean, finding the right contrast for a letter shape is not something that is like, oh, right, yeah, I do it. But I think a good advice in these terms would be to, you know, for you to also practice different calligraphic styles. So try to give it a shot to calligraphy. You don't need to be a great calligrapher. You just need to understand how certain tools work, and that will give you a lot of information to draw your letters when you're doing lettering.
All right, yes, this is based on the technique that Will Patterson was using.
Yeah.
Okay. But in this case, you know, because the lines are thin, the thick and thinness of the lines doesn't really matter because that's another type of style. It's not like trying to recreate the brush.
That's true. At the same time, you can, you know, when two lines of the same thickness come together, then you get, for instance, in the E over there, this in this connection, like you get a thick spot. Then, so there, you know, even when you're working with a monoline, you need some sort of adjustment, like optical adjustment.
Let's
of
look
those.
At one last one here.
Yeah.
Oh, Winter Wishes by Roz.
Nice. So. That's vector drawing, yeah.
Let's look at it big.
Okay, yeah. Nice. I feel that the which is really common. The dots of the eye are really small. Yeah, and the contrast is working well. Mm-hmm. I think tomorrow it will help you, since we're gonna speak about digital drawing. I think it could be useful for you to get some curves a little bit smoother. So for instance, the you know, all this flourishing you're using, it might help you, you know, the techniques we will be looking at might help you to get those curves really smooth.
All right, so let's get back to your sketches. And you know what I'm gonna do? I'm gonna let you sketch.
Yeah.
All right? Okay. Because, you know, you said you sketch much faster, you know, too much talking. So why don't you sketch this layer number 5?
Yeah.
While we will be ruffling out a print of the final work of Martina's lettering project here. Which will be finished on Thursday, because remember, we are on day one of our live lettering Adobe Live broadcast here on adobelive.com. So the way it works is that I'm going to ask you to type a word into the chat, and we have an automated system called Nightbot, who will then pick a lucky winner out of everyone that actually typed the word in the chat. Also, and I need to tell you that, is that if you subscribe to the Adobe Creative Cloud YouTube channel, you have five times more chances to win. Okay, Nightbot likes people who are subscribed to the Adobe Creative Cloud channel. If you don't want to subscribe to the Adobe Creative Cloud channel, that's fine too, but just remember that you have a little bit less chances to win a print of this lettering piece that Martina's working on. So I'm gonna ask everybody, because this is a really important part of lettering, just write thick and thin. All right, you need to write thick and thin in the chat. 3 words. Does that work? Does Nightbot like 3 words? Okay, it works. Sorry. All right. Yes, Nate, I don't think you can win twice, of course, right? No, it's Nightbot doesn't.
The print, yes.
Yes, okay, the print, yes. Yes, Creative Cloud, you can just win once a year. We will be doing a Creative Cloud giveaway in about 50 minutes. Oh, thick and thin, they're all coming in. Thick and thin, because this is really the basis. And we see it as Martina's sketching here. There's a lot of thinness and thickness in the letters. And this really gives you the sense of something that's been painted with a brush or with a calligraphic pen. In this case, more like a brush, because it starts rounded. And I see that you're adding, you don't need to answer, just keep on sketching, that you're adding some roughness to the letters as well, like some little, I like that.
Yes, okay. I am.
Junior just put thick and thin with a musical note. All right, I think we have enough, and we're gonna let Nightbot choose a winner for us. Rob White, you are the winner. So Rob, what you need to do is to contact, well, first of all, go over to Twitter and follow M Chaise, Michael Chaise, on Twitter. And he will then reach out to you with the instructions of what to do to claim your prize. And remember to come back today, tomorrow, day after tomorrow, to see exactly how this piece of live lettering actually proceeds with Martina. Oh, thank you, Veronica. Just referred my lettering students to this. Thank you. I have this vision of in every creative studio around the world, in all the schools, the TV always on with these live streams on. And you can just tune in whenever you see something that piques your interest. All right, Rob. Rob is already following you, Michael. It should be all good to go. Yep. Okay, can you just say hi, Michael, on Twitter, and so he will recognize you, Rob. Congrast and thin. Oh, I'm glad you're so happy, Rob. Awesome. Yeah, Mezer, like, this is a question that we have, like putting a camera right on top of our head would be nice, but right now we can't do that. It is a GoPro, we could like fix it to your head or something, you know, like, so.
Actually, you could. I actually will have to stay watching my piece of paper the whole time, but technically, yeah.
Grafissimo says, shouldn't it be in Spanish, ancho y angosto? No, this stream is not in Spanish today. We will be experimenting with streams in other languages. Like in February, we are preparing a stream in German.
Are you really?
Yes.
Well, yeah. Will you be streaming?
We will be streaming from here.
Paris, okay. Yes.
And it's all going to be about graphic design and, you know.
Who will be the host? Can you tell?
I will. Ah, okay. I speak German.
Yes. Ah, you didn't know. Okay.
He's Swiss. He can speak.
All right.
1 no, you don't have to learn German because we will also be doing a stream in English the week before. Yeah, February will be busy. I don't want to think about it just now. All right, so that's sketch number 5.
Yeah, I'm just, for instance, here I'm experimenting a little bit about this, you know, incorporating some of this spikes I was thinking of, you know, it's maybe like a...
Is it more thorns or is it more...
Yeah.
Like maybe... Is it furry?
I don't know. I don't know. That's why I was trying. Like, what if I have, you know, the
maybe
sketch...
Maybe you want to show from the top?
Yeah, sure. So I'm trying to incorporate some sort of spikes over there. I don't know if it looks a little bit...
Let's ask the chat. Do you like the spikes?
Yeah, I feel it looks like a heavy metal band or something. Yeah. You know, like, but I don't know. I wanted to incorporate something that makes this a little bit less sweet, and to have some sharpness in my drawing. So what I mean with this, it doesn't matter if I'm gonna stick to this or not. But I mean, I just did this drawing in just a few minutes. Mm-hmm. So I can, if I had this idea in my mind, then I can, you know, prove it right away and see if I like it or not.
Yeah, like Mary also said, it looks furry.
Furry, okay, it looks furry. That's not the idea. Okay, looks like for, yeah, I see. Why love? Maybe. Yeah.
Oh, everybody's agreeing it looks like fur.
Yeah, crazy. Okay.
Oh, it reminds them of Elmo's fur. You remember Elmo? Yes, or thorns. But basically that depends on, well, maybe thorns. I don't know. Let's see how it proceeds.
Yeah, exactly. So, well, I just want to try it out and see, you know, if this is something I could incorporate or not. So, and let's see how it works also with all the decorative elements.
Valentina sees a pain in it. She said, it looks too sharp to be furry. Like, it's painful.
It's painful. Okay.
Yes.
Yeah, that's true.
Love can be painful.
Yeah. So, that's what I'm trying to... That's the story.
Funny how people see, like, you know, like sharp and painful and some furry, comfy love, you know, the love cat.
I think in a way, you know, or my take on lettering is that it should be really straightforward, or at least that's my approach. It might be obvious sometimes and. You know, but it's funny, like, as a graphic designer, most of my life as a graphic designer in the past, I was always, you know, pursuing the values of Swiss school or,
yes.
You know, German school, which is,
like very
yeah, and everything, like, super clear,
yeah.
Like Helvetica and stuff. And now, now that I live in Germany, my pursuit is totally the opposite.
Yes, it's like a counter-reaction.
Yeah, totally. Yes. So it's...
Bauhaus.
That's
blech,
very interesting.
You know?
Yeah, yeah.
Round shapes. There's some questions about, you know, like, how many options do you typically show a client?
Oh, that's a good question. I mean, I think, or it didn't work for me so good to show many options
mm-hmm.
to the client. I think showing many options to the clients shows the clients that there's many options
mm-hmm.
and you know there is and but the client wants to pursue all of
yeah,
them
yeah.
So I think the best is sometimes to say like okay I show you this and this is I think what works
mm-hmm.
and this direction
yeah.
works and if you think it doesn't then let's see
I'll
something
start
else
over.
Yeah,
yeah
exactly.
I think I do exactly the same. I had a design company for about 20 years in
mm-hmm.
Florence and that was my approach too is like this is it.
Yeah.
Let's talk about it. I think this is the right solution. I mean, no, like working on it, I would have maybe, you know, like 10 different solutions, but I would always show the client one.
Yeah.
The one that I think works best.
Yeah, because also when you show many options and
mm-hmm.
they decide for one option, then there's a moment throughout that process where you're working on one option that they think like, what if we would have gone farther with the other
mm-hmm.
option you show
mm-hmm.
in the beginning. So
mm-hmm.
there's
yeah,
always
yeah.
like a, you know, an undecided
yeah.
client over there, which is, yeah, never really good.
Yes, David, today Martina is sketching with her pencil and tracing paper, like trying to like find exactly the right composition, the right tone of the illustration. We started from a very rough concepts inside of her moleskin, which you can actually see here on the screen. Not the sketches, but the moleskin is right there.
Yeah, that's true.
There. And, you know, we had the word peace, the word love, and then Martina decided to go with the word love. Evil Cerise, a longtime follower, says that looks very beautiful.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Ah, people are starting to dig the sharper spikes.
Really?
Yeah.
It does look interesting, I feel. I think it also looks like a, you know, wildlife related.
Mm-hmm.
Sort of from the jungle or something. Let's see.
The two bottom pieces look like it's a breaking heart.
Which?
These ones, maybe.
Like... Yeah, that's true. Mm.
How do they do, like...
Okay, yeah. So, can get pretty, you know. You know, handwork.
What harness is your pencil? HB?
HB, yeah. Yeah, if it would be softer, like 2B or something, this would be a mess.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, harder makes you push the pencil a lot more on the paper. Yeah.
So, yeah, we just said an HB pencil. So how is your concept evolving here? Because we had this very, like, very bubbly, kind of splashy kind of love, and now suddenly there's thorns in it and it starts to hurt.
Yeah, that's true. Well, I'm open to see what works better, and I'm open to see whether I like this new look and it communicates something stronger than the other love, like, or the other option I was sketching. I think also, even when I'm trying out options, like incorporating these thorns and stuff, I think I'm still solving certain composition issues, or, you know, like, so I move forward trying out new stuff, but also, you know, solving things that I think are not working very good.
And yes, Ali Jean, tomorrow we will be taking this to Illustrator.
Yeah.
But I think it's kind of cool that on an Adobe live stream, we actually have 2 hours of sketching with pencil and paper. Actually, this is something that I see so frequently. With, you know, this thing we do, it's called Creative Jams.
Uh-huh.
But we have people like, in 3 hours competing against each other. Like, we give them a concept, and then, like, there's like up to 10 teams, like, no, yeah, about 10 teams working with that concept, and then nice. There's a winner in the end.
Yeah.
One thing that I always noticed is that everything always starts on paper.
Yeah.
And pencil. It's very, very difficult to find somebody who doesn't start like that. So David, no, usually it doesn't take her that long to sketch. Usually it's much faster. It's just because there's this nagging Rufus sitting right next to her and asking questions and basically
a good conversation, though. Yeah, I like it.
So
I'm
usually,
not complaining.
usually Martina works in silence. Or
oh,
do
yeah.
you work with music or?
Yeah, I do work with music. Yeah, Not necessarily, like, I'm... Yeah, I
heavy
like
metal.
Metal. So, yeah, I mean, I am sketching for 2 hours now. But if you, even if you're sketching slow, if you think about it, like a 2 hour sketching process, and you know, by the end of that process, you have a sketch that you can show to a client, 2 hours is not much really. And you know, you have something that the client can see and you can discuss about. And so I think in terms of, even when you're sketching slow, in terms of,
And I think the shape of the heart is coming back.
It's coming back, right? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So...
Yeah, I used to teach graphic design to students in Florence, like American college students.
Okay.
And probably the first 5 to 6 weeks of the term, I would never let them go to the computer. They hated me for that. But the results were so much better.
Well, I think, you know, like the thing with computer, or personally, what I think it's not a plus of showing something that is not finished in a computer sketch or in a digital file is that it looks finished. So if you show something to a client that you think is just the beginning, the client will think it's not the beginning.
Yeah.
If you, even if you say like, hey, this is just the beginning, it will develop, the client will always, if he likes that, he will always point back at that.
Yeah, you did show me.
Exactly, yeah. Remember that drawing you showed me in the beginning? Why don't we go back to that? Sorry, I have just came up back off, came out of the room.
Sure, and you have little mints there.
Yeah, I have my, my medicine.
Yes, the medicine from Switzerland. They have that, that, I don't know if you have that in the adverts here. It's like the gute Kraft. Gute Kraft.
What is that?
It's Swiss German. I can hardly say it. Gute Kraft. Die Kräuterkraft.
Ah, okay. Wow, it, it's really magical.
David Wong, no, no, no. I mean, Wacom has, of course, its place in the, like this is something that I said before. Is you know, we have creatives coming here on stream that start write an Illustrator using a Wacom or a mouse or whatever tool is you know apt for them. Some other designers like sketch on an iPad with an Apple Pencil and then send that over to Illustrator or Photoshop. Other designers like Martina sketch on paper until they get the shape just right and then move over to Illustrator. It's all a matter of what works best for you. So Wacom is good, iPad is good, the mouse is good, pen and paper are good too. Yeah, that's right, Ashley. Sketching is important. I think that's the fastest way to get ideas out of your brain into the real world. So Michael, did you get in touch with Rob White?
Almost.
Okay. Oh, you've added some things
some
there. Yes.
Things, some ideas. But let me go back to my fourth layer. Just to talk a little bit about.
But these movement lines that you've just put in.
Yeah.
It actually makes me more think of feathers now. Like a big pillow fight.
Yeah. No? Totally. Yeah. That is true. I was actually thinking of this as little hints. You know, like the thing is that now I'm working just with one color, mm-hmm. so it's
yeah.
just pencil mm-hmm. color, and it's hard to say what comes in the background mm-hmm. and what comes in the foreground. So I was thinking of these lines as something really subtle in the background. Yeah, just to add some sharpness to it, and you know, to have some idea of volume,
mm-hmm.
sort of.
And depth, maybe?
Exactly, yeah. So maybe I'm gonna show this sketch or not. So here we are. So in terms of shapes, I think, you know, if you look at the O, I dismissed this loop over there because I think, you know, if I look at the V over here, it has this big stroke, and I feel that, you know, this this sort of eye of the O is not showing up anywhere, so I can sort of unify those two shapes by making this O, you know, the loop of the O sort of like a single shape. And I think that already looks better. You know, I can find a relationship between that loop, that shape over there, and also the weight of this shape over here, right? Mm-hmm. So this is sort of like you start finding consistency in your drawing. Also, if you look at the, you know, the decorative elements around, then you can start finding certain weights that are related here, right? So that on one hand, I also added, just to try it out and see how it works, this thorns, you mm-hmm. said, or these spikes over there. I'm not sure whether that's gonna stay or not, but it's just an idea. I think it's cool when you're working just to, you know, have, for instance, a situation like this where you can, on the same design or composition, you have two different approaches and you can decide whether you go this way or that way.
One thing that's gone is the little dots here.
Yeah, that's gone too.
Let me just show the dots again.
That's true. I can actually, I was thinking actually of incorporating that soon, but I'm not sure. I might incorporate it later on.
I think the chat likes the dynamism of the new version.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think so too. I think maybe you know, I don't know, I'm just brainstorming. This is something mm-hmm. I could actually try out in the next layer. But I think maybe the fact that there's, you know, too many thorns makes it look furry. Mm-hmm. Maybe I need just a couple of cuts, you know, just to have mm-hmm. some cutouts
yeah.
in the type. Maybe I don't need like, you know, like I just go closer. I don't need like three thorns here, but just one, you know, so sort of simplifying these thorns will make it look less furry and a little bit more, it's still sweet or soft, but at the same time with this, you know, little edges that I want to incorporate. Yeah, let's see.
Are we good there?
Hello, I'm Flo is asking, how many drawings do you usually do for client work, like we're doing right now? I guess that completely depends as well.
Yeah, that's true. But I have to say that also with the time, I do less layers. I mean, before I used to do maybe 10 layers or something, and now I narrow it down to 5 or something. But of course, it depends on the project. But I have to say that, yeah. More or less.
Until
I
it feels right.
Until it feels right. Yeah. But I have to say that also, like, now I have, you know, after making so much, I have reached a point where I know, where I can plan ahead what I'm going to do or what I want to do. So I can, you know, project sort of how this drawing will be developing later on the digital drawing. Yeah, and that's true, a lot of practice, actually.
I wanted to, like, do some advertising for you, Martina, because...
Oh, yeah.
Like, this is your store.
Yeah, I know.
And, yeah, and I just noticed your pin here. This is this pin right here.
Yeah, I'm pretty excited about the store. Yeah. It's like a...
Oh, letterpress cards and capital prints. Wow.
Yeah, it's like a new little side project of mine. And I'm also having some help with that in my studio. So I'm pretty excited about it. And it's something that has been in my head for a while. And it's great to see it, you know, it's becoming real.
MartinaFloorGoods.com. Back to you. So yes, for those of you asking if the videos will be archived, as soon as the stream is over, boom, they'll be on the Adobe Creative Cloud YouTube channel for your later vision. And but like I always say, where all the action is happening is actually on adobelive.com. That's where we have information about, you know, we have the chat there, we have of course the live stream, we have the schedule of everything that we have scheduled for the next 3 days, because this is day number one of 3 days of live lettering. And we have Will Patterson with us, we have Charlotte Smith, we have Peter Sizer, and Martina Floor, of course. And all of these guests will be for us for 3 days, over the next 3 days. So mark your calendars. There's even a little add to calendar button. If you don't want to miss Martina tomorrow, there's a button for that and you can put it into your calendar. And we also have a contest, and you can have a look at the at what we're asking the audience to create for that contest. And basically, using Photoshop CC or Illustrator CC, you have to create your best lettering artwork and share it on Twitter using the Adobe Live hashtag, Adobe Live. And then Michael will announce the winners on Friday, January the 13th, on his own Twitter account, on MShares. And basically that's your chance to win a 1-year Creative Cloud subscription. Ashley's asking, when you shop around for vendors or printers, like, you know, to create your pins or things like that, do you shop around in your area or do you go very far?
Like if I work with international suppliers, mm-hmm. or yeah, it depends. I actually like to, for instance, our letterpress cards are made by someone in the US,
mm-hmm.
and because we've been collaborating, or my studio has been collaborating with them for mm-hmm. a while, and you know, we love them, and you know, I also work internationally,
mm-hmm.
you know, my clients are everywhere in the world, mm-hmm. and I think it makes sense mm-hmm. that I also work with people in different places in the world.
Staying in silence so that Martina can sketch. All right, Peter Caesar is in the house. Whitney, Martina is using an HB pencil.
Yeah.
Mm. Yes, because there's people coming in, getting out of the live stream.
Nice, okay.
So sometimes you have to repeat the things. Pardon? Yes?
So I found Rob.
You found Rob. Okay, great. Rob, you were found.
It took some time. Some people tried to steal
his identity. Are you really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Nice.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. So, for our next giveaway, we will be giving away a 1-year Creative Cloud subscription. Okay. So in the chat, what I want you to do is to write a short sentence. Creative Cloud is. What is Creative Cloud to you? And basically the words Creative Cloud, the two words Creative Cloud have to be in the sentence. And we have Nightbot, our automated system, pick a winner for us. And remember that if you subscribe to the Adobe Creative Cloud YouTube channel, you have 5 times more chances to win in these raffles. So hit that subscribe button before you head over to the chat. And remember that the best way to do that is right here on adobelive.com. So if you're watching this on YouTube or Facebook or Twitter, come on over to adobelive.com. Creative Cloud is essential. Creative Cloud is great inspiration. Creative Cloud is everything you need in one place. Creative Cloud is genius. Well, only positive things about Creative Cloud. Thank you, guys. What? Yeah. Brilliant. Is Create Anything. Creative Office is the boss. It's awesome. Is income. Yeah. Is love. Okay. All right. Okay. So, at the top of the hour, in about 20 minutes, we will have Peter Caesar coming here. And okay, so we've seen a few processes today. So we have Will Patterson, who starts his designs on an iPad with the Apple Pencil, using Adobe Photoshop Sketch. In the second part, we have Martina here with us, using pencil and paper, and Peter Caesar has brought his light table with him. So I'm very curious to see how that'll work out. All right, I think we can ask Nightbot to choose a winner. And Let's see. Oh, so much positivity. I love it. All right, whenever Nightbot is ready. Nightbot is very slow today. Wake up, Nightbot. Is he?
Scott Strawbridge.
Scott Strawbridge, you've won a 1-year subscription to the Adobe Creative Cloud. So what you need to do, Scott, is to reach out to Michael Shez, M. Shez, on Twitter. Just follow him and send him a quick message. Hey, I'm Scott, and Michael will provide you with all of the necessary information to claim your prize. So congratulations to Scott Strawbridge. All right. Scott says, hi, cool. Yeah, it is cool.
Yeah,
1 year.
Totally.
And the chat is so educated. Everybody's congratulating Scott. This is, we have beautiful people in the chat. Oh, he just put his Twitter handle there, Scott's1. So you can quickly check that. Yeah, that's much easier, right? But why didn't we think about that?
No, you can. That's.
It's not? It's him, though. Ah, okay. Scott, are you sure about your Twitter handle there? Ah, Rob White, yeah, the winner circle. It's a special circle here on AdobeLive.com. They create little clubs like, hey, are you a winner? Yeah, Maria, that's a good question. What was your sentence, Scott? What did you write? Incredible how quickly you go ahead when I'm not there bugging you. And yeah, and Martina's right. Just created another sketch.
So I'm incorporating those again. The little dots.
Little confetti.
Yeah.
Yes, of course you can do the same thing with the Adobe apps on the iPad. Of course you can, but Martina works like that. So there's no way, you know, there's no real reason.
Yeah, exactly.
You know,
I
you could
it,
you could try.
Yeah,
you know,
totally.
And maybe,
I think
maybe
just,
you completely dig it.
Totally. It's what I just said in the beginning. When I saw Will, who was streaming before me, working on the iPad and being able, you know, to cut up things and move them around and stuff, I thought it was really amazing. And I bet there's, you know, tools to do that digitally. And I'm really looking forward to try them all out. I think also if you like to work on paper, you should go ahead and do it. And you know, if it works for you, then why not? So yeah, what I said on the other drawing that I would try out is to make those spikes or those thorns a little bit less. So let me show the previous drawing and show the current drawing. So from those thorns that I had here, I sort of tried to reduce them to just the cutout on the letter. I think you can see it here on the O pretty clearly. Here I have like three cutouts or three thorns, and then that becomes sort of like just a cutout in the letter. And I think that already works a lot better. I would love to hear what everyone thinks.
Yeah, give your feedback in the chat. Which ones do you prefer? The more flurry fluffy ones or the more like
that one?
Edgy and cutty ones?
I think also, well, in terms of shapes, I noticed that the L, for instance, here was you know, I thought, well, maybe on the next composition, I try to make the L go backwards or laid backwards. How do you call that? Like lean backwards.
Lean, okay.
Lean backwards. So I thought I will just make this L a little bit to the, you know, the axis a little bit to the back. And I think it already starts working better than before. Before everything had like the same sort of angle over here.
People prefer the one on the right.
Okay.
And some people prefer the flurry one, but fluffy.
So
I guess it's gonna be up to you, Martina.
Thanks. So yeah, but as I said, you know, like from one to the other, I tried solutions like features like this. You know, instead of doing this three thorns, I just did a cutout on the letter, and I also improved shapes. So this L is not slanted anymore to the front, but, you know, rather to the back. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think that it's starting to work better. Yeah. So there's always something you can change and improve. And that's also, you know, from this technique, that's also dangerous that you can go into iterations
on and on.
And at some point you have to decide, okay, this is fine. I stay here. This is, you know, this is the direction I'm going to follow. And I try to get this
Yeah,
as
because
good as I can.
We only have a few minutes left today.
Yeah.
That flew.
Yeah, okay.
Right? Two hours, boom.
Wow.
Gone, right? And basically, so today we spent the whole 2 hours Martina sketching on tracing paper. And basically what we're going to be doing tomorrow is start to digitize that, right?
Exactly. I think what I normally do is to basically scan this, so turn it into a digital file, and then I import it in Illustrator and I basically draw it all over. So that's what we are gonna see tomorrow, like how to draw letter shapes in vectors.
Yeah, awesome. So stay tuned. Stay with us here on AdobeLife.com because our next guest, Peter Caesar, will be showing yet another way to get ideas out of your mind onto into production. So thank you, Martina. See you tomorrow.
Yeah,
same time. You guys stay tuned. We're going to be right back in about 5 minutes.
Yeah, a little bit.
A little bit more, like at the top of the hour.
Maybe you can invite them to do the contest.
Yes. So we don't need to go to my screen now because otherwise they're going to see the video. If you go to AdobeLife.com, which is the place to watch all of this, we know we have the chat, we have a schedule that tells you everything that's happening over the 3 days that are upon us. Yes, because this is a 3-day live stream.
Wow.
This is day one. And now we're going to have Peter Caesar and then Charlotte Smith doing the night shift with me. Like that's from, 10 p.m. to
midnight
to midnight in Paris, but it's a very good time for those of you who are on the West Coast in the U.S. And then tomorrow we're gonna start over again with Will Patterson, Martina again with Peter and of course Charlotte for the night shift. And then at the last tab here, there's the contest tab on AdobeLife.com, and that's where you can find all of the information you need to submit your artwork to Twitter using the Adobe Live hashtag. And Michael right here, you can actually see a piece of him. Yeah, you can see his hand. he will announce the 10 lucky winners of a 1-year Creative Cloud subscription. 10 winners on Friday, January the 13th. On Friday the 13th, let that sink in. Let that sink in, Friday the 13th, okay.
Okay.
Thank God we're not streaming on a Friday the 13th.
Okay.
Right? All right, guys. Stay tuned.
Bye.
We'll be right back. AdobeLife.com.